That blessing was given to us on the sixth day of that particular week. We're looking now at the seventh day and what all of that led to. So the sixth day of the week, Jesus in the evening shared the Lord's Supper with his disciples and was with them and preparing them for what was to take place that they could not even imagine. And then as the day followed through and all the atrocities of the day and the difficulty of it on that sixth day, and if you study the Bible on 6 days, in particular in Revelation, there's a lot of rough stuff takes place. Lots of destruction, lots of punishment. And of course, Satan, he's all about those things, but this time he's the one that's getting corrected. But when the seventh day comes around, there's absolute peace and quiet and grace. And so we see Jesus on the seventh day, he's in the tomb. And I believe that he's resting, for God rested on that seventh day. I know there are passages that we can talk about and discuss lots of different things and ideas, but sometimes we need to take hold of what we do have and not get too opinionated about the details, but just simply understand the grace and the fullness of Christ in each and every word that's presented to us. And so I want you to look then in Genesis. We're going to start with chapter 2, the first verses there. Let's stand together for the reading of the word. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all the host of them. And on the seventh day God ended his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work which he had made. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he had rested from all his work which God created and made. These are the generations of the heavens and of the earth when they were created, in the day that the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. And every plant of the field before it was in the earth, and every herb of the field before it grew, for the Lord God had not caused it to rain upon the earth. And there was not a man to till the ground. But there went up in the midst from the earth and watered the whole face of the ground. And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace and love this day. Allow your word to sink into our hearts. Allow our lives to sink into your word. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Verse 1, God completed. God always completes. If he's got a task that he's going about, he may work at it for a day or a few thousand years or bazillions of years. I don't know what he does, but he's always going to come to completion. He's going to end it. He's going to have it exactly the way it ought to be. If things get out of line, he corrects it, but it's going to be complete. That's what marriage is all about, is two people learning to be complete together. It's what work is about, completing your tasks and being responsible. And that's what all of our life is about, is following him, that we might be complete as individuals and as human beings and as nations in the things that we do. You know, I know a number of you have been praying and wanting us to see a godly nation, a nation of people that aren't outnumbered again, that come up and worship Christ as Lord and Savior. I'm going to share with you, this is not an advertisement, but I want to share with you that you need to give to any godly effort like this missions offering if you want to see America changed. Amen. These people are reaching America. And so if you've not yet given, give. And you pray about what God would have you give. I know things get in the way. The joy of giving is stepping out and sometimes anxiously trusting God, but nevertheless trusting him that he will take care of you in spite of the gifts that you give. you give what you can. You give a little extra. And you just sit back and watch what God will do. It may not come back in money. As a matter of fact, it often doesn't. But you can look at a child or a grandchild and see the joy that's there in the fullness and realize that it's God that's done that and given that gift to you. And that gift is worth more than all the things that we struggle for and try to protect. So little children and loved ones and those full of grace that might be reached in the future, not only yours, but others that may come to know Christ as Lord and Savior because of these missionaries. It's important. That's part of making America complete. That's part of us being complete in Christ Jesus. And so the completeness of this is just so important in verse 1. Verse 2, where it mentions the seventh day, it talks about a generation. Have you noticed that word? This is the generation. It's the time. It's the time span. It's whether it's days or years or whatever it is. God looks at things differently than we do. And we have to get a hold of that. And, you know, just a moment to him may be thousands of years to us. God is so far ahead of us. We really can't define everything that we think we can define. These words are often have a lot of flexibility in Christ himself, and sometimes we make them very stringent. So I don't know all those answers, but I do know this. This seventh day is a big thing. This seventh anything in the Bible somehow is a big thing. It was God told Noah, in 7 days I'm going to cause it to rain. And so he closed them up in safety on that day. And so they were safe. So in 7 days I'm going to cause it to rain. And so he put them in there and he got them ready for that time and for that day. Jericho fell on the seventh day. What a victory. As they marched around and around and around. How many days? 7, I believe. And so on the seventh day, the walls fell down. And sometimes, listen, when we come to know Christ as our Lord and Savior, walls fall down. Sometimes as Christians, we build walls back. And we have to look at them and get a conviction about it and sometimes get them out of our way so that we can serve him better and do more of what he wants us to be. The Passover was the seventh day. The Jewish Passover, that first one, that day killed the lamb and followed all the instructions of God. They killed the little lamb and they took the blood and they put it on the doorposts. And it wasn't long ago I was sitting listening to a sermon. I was sketching, writing notes and things, and I sketched out a little door and I looked at it and I thought, death couldn't go through there. Death can't go through that door. We get to go through a door that death cannot go through. We get to see the blood of Christ. And that blood of Christ protects us on the other side as we believe in him as our Lord and Savior. And so when we come to know him as personal Lord and Savior, that applies to every style and everything that we do in living. We're to live according to that in that house. We're in the house of Jesus Christ. We're of the generation of Jesus Christ. And so as we know him and we walk with him, we have protection. Satan cannot come through the door. He can make a lot of noise outside and lightning, and sometimes when I'm in the house and I know I'm safe, and boy, one hits really loud, really close, I can't help but jump. I don't know if you've ever been there or not, but boy, I want to tell you, I can jump. And I think about it, and I think, well, I don't know what I did that for. I'm safe. If it had hit me, I wouldn't have known it anyway. I'd just seen Jesus. But, you know, the seventh day, it is so amazing. You get Christ in the tomb on the seventh day, our wonderful Passover. It ends our week. It ends our work week. Even the world still functions by that and doesn't understand the meaning of a seven-day week. Why couldn't it have been 10 or 8 or 3 or 5? I think we ought to keep the Sabbath holy in our hearts and in our lives. And on Sunday, we ought to be in the Lord's house. And that's not true for everyone in every place. I once worked at the state prison. And I realized that if I don't work on Sunday, if all the guys didn't work on Sunday, if we went to church on Sunday, when we came back on Monday, there probably wouldn't be too many guys there. They're going to find a way to get loose. And so sometimes there are necessities in the military and in the police force and in our hospitals and places like that. There are some necessities, but many of what we call necessities are for personal convenience and finances and money and other things. And it may not be, you have to pray about it, I think each person does, but you have to pray about those things about the seventh day. When you get into Revelation, you've got all kinds of sevens. I mean, they're just everywhere. And if you want to do a good study, I think you need to recognize that. There's seven seals and seven trumpets and seven vials, and all of those are poured out. And there's always violence in the first six of correcting things that God is getting straight. But on the seventh, it's a little different. And so read through those and see what that's all about. God has modeled for us this seventh throughout, and it's always comes to the point of resting in Him. And so it's at that seventh day in Revelations where everything is beautiful and all of His people is with Him, and Satan's been taken care of and put in his place eternally, and all of this goodness and joy and fullness of the fruits of heaven and the joy of eternal life are there. In those last couple of chapters, read those. Understand the Sabbath and what it means to be resting in Him. It's consecrated time to God, and it restores your energies. It's all about that restoration, just like the psalmist David said, "He restores my soul." That's what the Sabbath is about. We sit down and we walk with Him, and our spirit and everything about us, the soul in the Old Testament is talking not just about the spirit. We often interpret it that way, but it's the whole person, all of Him, spirit, body, mind, everything is in that word. And that's what David is talking about. If I have cuts or bruises or scratches, He puts the oil on them. He restores me and makes me healthy. Gets my mindset in the right direction, restores our energies. It's a celebration of satisfaction in Christ Jesus. Now, the word Sabbath does not mean here seventh. Sabbath means rest. And so we start calling Sabbath the seventh. That's not right. Sabbath is the day of rest, where we rest in Him, where we find strength for our soul. And God blessed it. God blessed everything else, and then He blessed a particular day. He blessed all of these things. He blessed the cattle. He blessed mankind. He told them to go out and be fruitful and multiply. But then He took this one day, and He blessed the day. That day that He created. Because it's going to be so much blessing in the future and for our future. So God blesses our respect of this day of rest. When we respect Him, if you can't be there on Sunday, when you take time aside to just rest in Him, now preachers sometimes get preacheritis. When your new preacher comes, I want you to watch him real careful. Because one of the things that has to often be told to us is, preacher, you preach about the seventh rest. The Sabbath rest. But you're not resting any day of the week. You're working 7 days straight. And we insist that you rest. Now, deacon body get a hold of that, and I believe they will. And it'll be good for him. And sometimes you need to challenge him and say, you know what? We want you to take an extra day or week or whatever it is, some kind of plan that you might set up, where he is sure to get a little extra, just alone time, just some rest time, where perhaps he can go aside and just study the Bible, a time to be with the Lord, not a time for just vacation. Vacation will wear you out. You know that? I used to run with my brothers and stuff, and I mean every weekend they were getting the boat and going skiing, and I was living in the house with my brother, and we'd go ski, and on Sundays we'd be skiing and fishing, And I want to tell you what, I was worn out by the time I was ready to go to work. We wear ourselves out telling ourselves that we're resting. When you're doing that kind of stuff, it just takes more energy, more time, more things that else that don't get done. But God sanctified it. He made it holy. He set it aside as special. You know, so, ladies, you've got things in your house that are kind of like that. As a matter of fact, my wife has some china that if I wash it, she's very nervous. I've broken some expensive stuff a lot in our family. So normally she's in there before I am. And she'll get to washing those dishes. But the common ones I get to wash. But there are certain things that are sanctified. There's certain things that I just don't mess with. And I know what it is, and our kids don't touch it. Nobody touches it except her, because she doesn't want it broke, she doesn't want it messed up, or it's been made for company that's coming. Don't touch that napkin. It's in the right form and shape and everything. And so there are certain things that get in a certain way that you have. I don't know what yours are in your house, but boy, once marriage takes place, we start finding out that there are certain things that has to be done a certain way or whatever, because it is set in concrete in your mind. One of those might be that the toilet paper has to go over the top. That's pretty simple and humble, but sometimes it's got to be that way, right? I saw some of you nodding your head already. That's the way it happens. So understand that when God puts something in here, how much more important it is. Let's not interfere with that. Let's rest in it. Let's walk into it. Let's be everything that He's created from this beginning of creation all the way to those last chapters of Revelation. He's talking about a complete, absolute, glorious, forever rest in Him. And the only way you can get there is from that time that Jesus Christ was crucified and placed in the tomb and arose on the first day. Knowing Him, believing in Him, believing in His death and resurrection as the Lord and Savior begins that great rest for you. And you have to get a hold of that. Verse 4 talks about the generations of the heaven and the earth. I thought that was an interesting word. You know, you look at it and say, well, days, just this was the first day, second day, third day. But he talks about generations. These are the generations. These are the, this is the foundation. This is all that took place. We don't understand the fullness of that. But I think it's probably a lot more than we can imagine. What's important is that it has an orderliness. And everything else God does through the nation Israel, through Noah, all the way through the Old Testament and Jesus Christ in the New, there was absolute order to everything He did, and all of it connected to the beginning and to the fall of mankind and the redemption of mankind until the end in Revelation. He's consistent about all of that. That's why the Bible is so valuable and so important. No religion has this except our only Lord and Savior Jesus Christ and the God that gave us these scriptures. No one has the things that are hidden here in their religion of how the earth was made and how it came together, and the fact that science, real science, agrees with that. And I believe there's a message in a way of redemption for people through those things to be able to point out those scientific facts of the earth and the making of it and all that's hidden here in the scripture that others ignore and can't see. There's a way to evangelize with those blessings, and God bless our groups that are studying that and using that for an evangelistic tool. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth. It calls on us to lift up our worship. It calls on us to set aside absolute, pure, holy time. And wives, you ought to encourage your husbands to make sure that they get their daily time with Him. And husbands, you ought to lead your wives to that same thing, and your children. There's a time each day And there's a walk through the day of resting in Him. And sometimes we get up and we may have a precious time in the morning and walk out and go to work, and the first thing you know, we've forgotten about everything else. Perhaps someone's tickled our anger box, or whatever else takes place. Frustration, hopelessness. Things start attacking us and trying to get us off guard and trying to get us to forget about Him. Those are moments where you stop and you walk aside, or you, in your mind and in your heart, you take some thought and begin looking for Christ working in it. Lord, how do you want me to work? What did I say? What did I do? Forgive me of that. Let me get on track. Let me be the person here in this moment that you want me to be, whether there's anyone else around or not. We have this walk with Him, and immediately will come the rest. And it, you know, if you look back to a problem, it'll have about 7 steps before you got there. And if we're walking through those, it works out pretty good if we're aware of Him. So take hold of that. Set time aside for Him in the morning. And through the day, be aware of Him. In the evening, again, set time aside for Him. It's your time, it's an attitude during that time, and it's a value. A value is something that goes far beyond just wanting to do a thing. A value has something that you're willing to die for. So if you were captured and you were taken to a prison camp, no matter what they would say, in your heart and in your mind, you would be praying and walking and talking to the Lord Jesus. If you come upon a place where there's temptation and there's things that are going wrong in your life and wanting to move you in the wrong direction, then there's this mindset and attitude, the value, is what will begin to kick in when you turn it toward Christ Jesus, or your attitude can go sour. And like a lot of the world uses that word in a negative sense. He's got an attitude. She's got an attitude. Well, an attitude can be a good attitude too. And that's where we live. We have to live in the proper attitude. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of failure. It's a lot of recovery through the day. Many times through the day. At least Mike O'Neill's attitudes take a lot of work. Maybe yours don't. Mine sure do. And when frustration and things come, I have to sit back and take a look at this. I have to understand the values. What are the core values? What is it I'm willing to die for in Christ Jesus? Would I give up my prayer life? And why won't I walk in it today? Why won't I stand in it today? Why won't I be who I need to be to someone who is being ungodly? Or if God has a word for me to say, I should say it. In His strength, in His power, and in His grace. And you know, sometimes when those words are said gently and in the power of Christ, people will walk away, and for years it may be stuck in the back of their mind until one day something happens and they find someone else that tells them again about Christ. But that time they fall to their knees after many years. How many years, Daryl, did you hear the Word of God and hear about the Word of God?
At least 10.
Before it happened. At least. My wife grew up going to church. It was a different kind of church. She'd never heard the gospel shared. We got married and went through, that first 6 months of her just mean as all get out. Well, I was a little bit bad too. We had a rough start. I've told you about that. But when she came to Christ, when I looked at my life and realized I wasn't walking in this plan that God has, that I'd not taken care of the Sabbath, I've not honored it in any way, I just lived for 8 years on my own doing what I wanted to do. Because Mama wasn't there to tell me to go to church. And that's what it amounted to. And she kept telling me, but I wasn't around her, so I didn't go. We got so miserable when we came to Christ, everything got so wonderful. It didn't take away the fussiness and the fighters. It didn't change all my bad habits nor hers, but we began to change them, and we began to work through them and walk with them, and we still butt heads and we still get hurt. We've been married 43 years-ish, somewhere in there. But you know what? This is where you start. You start by resting in Christ Jesus. It is a Sabbath rest. You've got to learn to understand and make holy the day so that you can understand and make holy the person of Christ Jesus. We have to start with the rudiment basics, these physical things that God has laid in front of us, and seek to understand the fullness of what he's saying in those. It's that message for us. Every portion of it, every Sunday, every work, every prayer, every morning, every hour, every minute of every day, we walk with him. That is our Sabbath rest. I pray that you're walking with him. And many of you are. But maybe you walk like I do sometimes, with a little bit of a limp. Or maybe your day just gets off track. Run to him. Don't walk. Run to him. Stop immediately. If you need to pull over, drive in the car, and close your eyes and pray, do so. It's important. God's Sabbath is eternal. It's every day. It's all day when you're in Christ Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, if there's a person here today that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, God, if they don't understand this rest and the peace and the grace and the fullness that you give us and allow us to live in on this earth, even though it's all confusing for us here, Father, we look forward to that day where all the confusion's gone and we are safe in your presence. And your power and your might and your glory just overwhelms us for eternity. And we sing holy, holy, holy forever and ever and ever. And it means more and more and more every time we say it. God, change our hearts and our minds. Help us to value those things that are most important. Father, your missionaries and the work that's being done and our ability to share the gospel in the most simple ways, God, take hold of us and let us get about this business of giving of our lives and giving of who we are and not be afraid in the process. Not fear that we're going to lose something, that something else is going to be missed out on, but that you take care of all things we can't outgive you. Father, glorify your name in us. Glorify your name today. If there's a person here, dear friend, if you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, if you don't have that safety, that presence, that presence to run into in difficult times, now's the time to change that and let Jesus be the absolute Lord of your life. Father, lead them in that. In Jesus' name, amen.